And greetings, everybody. Welcome to another edition of Celebrate Life. My name's Wayne Braverman. And one of the great things about this show is I get to interview and meet a lot of very interesting people, people who do fascinating things in their lives, people who have overcome a lot of obstacles in their life, people who have things to teach us, and people who entertain us in some very creative ways. Today, I think I have one of the most creative people I'm going to meet. You, if you ever watch Bedford TV, and hopefully you do, you know him as CC Clownsby, or perhaps as Cowboy Mike, or maybe Rocket Mike, or maybe Pastor Mike, or any other number of different creations that he has come up with. Today, we're going to talk to him as him. It is my great honor and privilege to introduce you to Mike Kelly. Mike, thank you. And
thank you, Wayne.
It's such a pleasure to have you here, and
thank
I'm not
you.
Used to seeing you without something, a clown.
Well, you know, it's kind of getting you used to the new look, because tomorrow in the studio I'll be Cowboy Mike, so I got the thing going here to look like
handlebar mustache.
Yeah, like a rough and tough
not
cowboy.
Handlebar. What's that called?
Fu Manchu, or cowboy mustache, I call it.
Cowboy Mike mustache.
Yes. Got to have it. You got to look, you know, like you've been out there kicking dust for a while.
No.
That's tomorrow.
That's tomorrow. And just to give people an introduction as to, just in case they haven't seen you, right here we're going to put in a little bit of a clip to show you in action so people get a sense of what it is that you do.
Wow.
Hi, everyone. This is CC Clownsby and Company, and CC will be entertaining you on his four-wheel scooter. So everyone sit back, and I hope you enjoy the show. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, I will. I'll be careful. Please be careful, CC. Okay. I'll talk to you later. Bye.
Man, Bojangles, and he danced for you in worn out shoes.
Happy birthday.
So that was very good. That's a little sampling of what it is that you do.
Okay.
How long does it take you to come up with this? You just get an idea in your head and you go, I'm going to sing this today.
Well, the ideas come from, you know, I'm always like creating something, whether even if it's not going to be used as a prop, but I'll be making a puppet or I'll be working on some bicycle that I think that I can, well, I can turn this into something that I can use for a show.
Mm-hmm.
So I start getting ideas, and then the next thing you know, now I'm tossing around maybe a dozen ideas.
Mm-hmm.
And about over a dozen more in the back burner.
Ah.
So I'm always like keeping the flow going by never running out. I don't think that I could ever run out of material, to tell you the truth, Wayne, because I could just start going over other things that I've done,
mm-hmm.
and just revamp them a little bit.
Yeah. Now, CC Clownsby, I think maybe the one you do the most, or
oh yeah, yeah, most definitely.
Where did he come from? How did you come up with him?
I can in brief tell you that years ago, back in 2013, the veterans had some company donate music equipment, amps, drums, guitars, and they had a jam session for the veterans. Mm-hmm. And one night, a bunch of us are there in a vacant, one of the vacant shops out way out behind the hospital. And a girl from the creative arts or the creative music, whatever she was from, come in. And she said, would any of you guys like to sign up for the talent show? So first, after we got a big chuckle, right, I said, sure, I'll come in with my cowboy hat and cowboy boots and sing Home on the Range. Right? So I did, and I ended up, of all things, they call me and they say, oh, Mike, we're going to have you go over to Bedford Studio.
Ah.
All right. I didn't go any further in the competition because there was so much talent out there.
Mm-hmm.
So the next year comes around, and, you know, this time I decide, hey, you know, that was fun. I'm going to be more prepared.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, of all things, to get to the, before I lose track, a lady that was in the audience watching the show was an artist,
uh-huh.
and she sketched me while I was up on stage.
Oh, my goodness.
I had the chaps, the boots, the guitar, right? And she says to me, will you sign this picture for me?
Oh, wow.
And I said, well, how about if I sign it Cowboy Mike? She goes, that'd be great. So I signed the picture. It was on like a, you know, like a sketch pad.
Mm-hmm.
And what a beautiful job she had done.
Oh.
So that contest, I ended up winning again.
Oh, my goodness.
I played a Hank Williams tune. Mm-hmm. I'm So Lonesome I Could Cry.
Oh, yeah.
And I just won everyone's heart.
Mm-hmm.
And I came back to the studio. Now, at that time, Brian was here, and Greg was here.
Yeah.
And when I finished recording the song, and I started talking to them, they're like, dude, what happened to your Texas accent? We thought you were, like, from Oklahoma or something. I said, no, I'm from Boston. I was born in Chelsea, right? They're like, wow.
Well, that's south of here.
So, well, you know, I grew up when we moved as kids to Wilmington. It was like, you know, boomtown to us.
Well, then you became a Northerner.
With the hospital, I mean, with the farm and all.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it was Brian, but I'm not sure. He said, so what other songs do you have under that cowboy hat other than cowboy tunes, right? And I said, well, let's see. Not counting the clown songs. And they're like, whoa, wait a minute. What do you mean? What's a clown song? I said, well, I write my own clown songs, which I do. Most of the songs in the clown. I will do, you know, other songs, but I enjoy writing clown songs. So then there was like, that's it, you're coming into the studio. So I came in and that was...
They recruited you.
Yeah, oh yeah. I came in my first show. It was, I'll never forget. I come in here, I had one of my clown bikes.
Mm-hmm.
And this is before we got to realize I need plywood down underneath me. I'm on this, it's in episode one, right? It's called the crazy bike. And you have to really be on your guard and on your game to ride it.
Uh-huh.
It's a unicycle with two wheels attached.
Holy
and they
cow.
Sort of slant in like this so that it won't flip.
Yeah.
But there's no steering wheel. You steer it like you're on a unicycle.
Goodness.
Right. Now you got to picture this. I got a puppet in my hand.
Yes.
I've got a guitar in my hand, and I'm on this machine that's really not meant for indoors, anyways. But we thought we could use it as like, you know, bring it in, and and I'm on it, and everything's like turning loose. It was so slippery on the floor, and I'm regaining all the balance that I have.
With the guitar and a puppet.
I'm playing the guitar, wow. And I got the puppet. And, accidents, nothing, not even, no trash in the studio didn't get trash. But then that's when we realized, hey, I'm going to get some plywood, lightweight plywood. Mm-hmm. And, I'll get some color to match the green screen, and we can put that down for the clown acts.
Yeah.
So that worked out pretty good. And I'm still using them today.
Yeah.
There's some of the acts, they just, I came in here into the studio one day with a quad. With the motor taken out of it.
Holy
and
cow.
We had balloons all tied on it, and I'm busting balloons off. What a show that turned out to be.
So you have a lot of fun doing this.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I was like, I was exhausted by the time we were done filming. I was like,
you get a workout.
Yeah, the most workout I ever got in my life in here was, I tried to surrender about three times, but them boys weren't letting the clown surrender that easy.
They kept pushing.
We decided to go within the Garden of Eden, right?
Uh-huh.
And they put the long version on. I never knew there was a short and long version.
How long's the long version?
However long the video is. It's on YouTube. It's call it the bicycle ride.
Is that about, I think that's about, 15 or 18 minutes or so?
To me, it was an eternity.
I bet it was.
Because I had all these bikes and stuff out here, and I'm riding them, and we're having the time of our life putting the show together.
Wow.
And I'm actually on the floor, coats off. I mean, you can see it in the show. I'm sweating. I'm like trying to get, mercy. I'm on the ground, 10-second count. And we just kept filming it, and it paid off because, I can do certain things, Wayne, mm-hmm. and it's nothing when it comes to, like, the editing.
Yeah.
The new videos that have just come out.
Yeah.
By the new what would you call the girl that edits the films now?
Like a producer?
She's the producer.
Or film editor.
She does such
editor.
A great job,
Yeah.
I mean, I get my hats off to her for the work that she's been doing.
Yeah, yeah. Now, when you were a child, you started playing with puppets then.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
Was that from your mom?
I got puppets when I was growing up. And you had a puppet when you were growing up in the 50s and early 60s. It was maybe Mickey Mouse.
Yeah.
Or, a Popeye. Or there's nothing like puppets that are out now. Except there was one occasion. Now, see, my brothers and I, we're all close in age. My brother, he was almost an Irish twin.
Huh.
He passed away in my arms.
Oh, my goodness.
A year older than me. And we were always playing the guitar and always doing the show thing together. He had just recently, he died in 2014. Oh, but he was involved in the, he went to one of the VA talent shows,
mm-hmm.
and then he started getting sick. And he was, him and I could play any song. And he played the lead, and I played the rhythm and would sing. And it was a great loss, even though, our lives took us different directions, so we were never like the Bee Gees, or we never grew up, we really didn't take it as a profession. It was always just something we enjoyed doing, and our whole family got together with guitars and banjos. Our great-grandfather used to play vaudeville.
He was a vaudeville performer?
Yes, he was. Grampy Greenlaw.
Huh.
And she's my second cousin. She holds all his old banjos and stuff because it was her grandfather.
Wow.
So that, you know, that's understandable. But good old Grampy Greenlaw, he was quite the guy.
Did you ever see him perform anywhere, or did he?
Only when he got in his elderly years, of course, at christenings, mm-hmm. he always would play the banjo,
yeah.
or attempt to play it. But at one point, you could tell it. You know, he was a banjo player, and it was the old four-string banjo.
Right.
And
wow, you have a large family. You have a lot of brothers and sisters, yes?
I have, there was six boys altogether mm-hmm. in the family.
Yeah. And you grew up on a farm?
Yeah, we did. We had our own, everybody actually had their own hoss. Can I just back up 1 second, Wayne?
Absolutely.
I started thinking about Charlie, and I still miss him to this day, and I always will. He was a great person. And when we were kids, he liked puppets too, just as much as me.
So you both shared in that?
Well, not really shared.
It was something you both had an
but
interest in.
He got a Howdy Doody marionette.
Oh, right.
Howdy now, he's Doody. A year older than me. Mm-hmm. I had a marionette puppet, but not like this Howdy Doody that my dad, wherever he picked it up, he brought it home. And I played with the... I was maybe 6 years old. He was 7 years old.
Uh-huh.
And somehow, I got the puppet tangled up. I seen my opportunity, and I wasn't being destructive, but somehow I tangled the puppet all up, right? My brother comes along, "What you do, wreck my Howdy Doody puppet?"
Oh.
And I'm like, no. Tug of war starts with the puppet now.
Uh-oh.
And my dad comes in, takes the puppet away, right? He fixed it. It wasn't broken. It was just they get tangled. You know, you learn how easily one can be tangled up now.
That's right.
Especially, I've been making them for years.
Making marionettes?
Oh, yeah. I make most of them all my own puppets.
Oh, wow.
But check this out. To the day... Well, not the day that my brother passed away, but up until the day. Yeah, my brother Michael wrecked my Howdy Doody puppet. He always would remind me.
Never got over it?
Never got over it. And, you know, I tried to find this thing for the show.
Uh-huh.
Like, I retired as a security officer, but before I did that, my brother and friends of ours, we used to work hard at doing roofing and carpenter work. That's how I got this hammer tattooed on my arm, a roofing crew.
Mm-hmm.
So when the weather got bad, we'd take puppets into the subway in Boston in our guitars.
Wow.
And we would put out the case.
Huh.
And we were them guys that, back when it first started.
Street performers.
Yeah. And we were like, why are we doing roofing and carpenter work? We were raking in the bucks.
You could make a lot of money.
We would be making anywhere, and this was in, let's see, early 90s.
Yeah.
We were all taking home 75 to 100 a day. What am I talking about? 3 or 4 hours, rush hour.
Wow.
Yeah.
I didn't think they could make that much doing that.
Yeah. Wayne, bustlers, I think we were called. I can't remember what. You had to get a permit. We got, the cops come down on us, get a permit, and you'll be fine. But we made we had all the puppets, and we had horses. We had to hire guys to come in to work some of the extra puppets that we brought in. Because had a whole show going on. And we stuck to songs like "She'll Be Coming Around the Mountain," and, "Buffalo Gals, Won't You Come Out Tonight."
Yeah.
We were all dressed up like cowboys. And what a time we had doing that.
Enormous fun. Now, your parents encouraged creativity, I'm guessing.
My parents, because of lack of money, I guess finances, that we learned as a family that when the horses needed horse blankets for the winter, the whole family would pitch in and make them. Mm-hmm. My mother and father would go out and get the material. And we'd learn to use the awls and the leather things. And like I make a lot of stuff too out of leather.
Oh boy.
In the Minutemen, the colonial reenactors, mm-hmm. I make all my own cartridge boxes and gaiters, and I make pouches. I make all my stuff.
Wow. And you are still a member of?
Oh yeah, I'm still a member. I'm not captain anymore.
You did that six times.
I'm a six-term captain, that's right, mm-hmm. With the Wilmington Minutemen.
Mm-hmm. And you just did July 4th in Boston.
As the Minutemen, Wilmington Minutemen, we did the parade in Boston. Mm-hmm. And the commissioner of the Boston Police Department was at, it's the park right there where Faneuil Hall is.
Yes.
You know that where you climb up the big stairs and you're at that little place?
Well, yeah, by Government Center.
Government Center. You march from there and you go around.
Plaza. Yeah.
By the old cemetery and
come
out at the old state house, I think.
Yes, you go to the old state house.
Yeah, and they have a big speeches and all that.
Yeah.
Well, the commissioner, he's going around getting pictures taken. And somebody said, can you get a picture with us? And he goes, well, where's my musket? So I handed him. I had my brother Charlie's musket. He was big on the Minutemen. I handed him, and he's in the picture with Charlie's musket like this with a big smile on his face. And it's like, you know, I could just feel Charlie looking down on me. Mm-hmm. Like, after he had died, the night he died, the police told me to secure his musket. He had been living with me. I have a big shed out mm-hmm. in my backyard. And I lived down by Silver Lake, and it was almost like someone made the shed to have people come up, like a little cottage. Well, my brother was living out there, and I had thought that he had cleaned the musket, but he didn't get to cleaning it, and he passed away right after. A week or two after Flag Day, and he was at a ceremony. So he didn't get to clean his musket. And I thought it was clean, and I found this musket frozen in time, because gunpowder can really set up like rock hard mm-hmm. if it's not clean. And I just took my time and cleaned it, and got it going again, and now it's back to working like it always did.
Yeah. What's it feel like to be a Minuteman, to be? Like, because you go to the Concord Bridge, you go to the pole capping here.
I have been to the Concord Bridge, and I've marched with the Bedford Minutemen a couple of years. Mm-hmm. We marched down 62 into Concord. But I know one thing, it's a long walk. A few times the Minutemen, myself included, took the march from Wilmington to Concord.
Wow.
Took us all night.
That's quite a few miles to do that.
Took us all night.
So you get more of a sense of appreciation of what the Minutemen back in the...
To tell you the truth, I get more of appreciation. We used to march to the 62 Bridge, and as a memory thing.
Yeah.
Because we fired the night of the Patriots' Day, when the Minutemen got their call arms. Mm-hmm. They marched and heading for Lexington.
Yeah.
And it was 2 o'clock in the morning. So the Wilmington Minutemen have gotten permission from the town to fire our muskets from the high school all the way up to the center of town, starting at 2 a.m.
Huh.
And we come out blasting, let me tell you, every year. people now, they line up. They know it, say we may as well wait until they go by because they're only going to wake us up. And
you are a veteran yourself.
I am an Air Force veteran, and I served during the Vietnam War, so I'm a Vietnam-era veteran. I didn't go to Vietnam, but I was in doing what Uncle Sam told me to do.
And that was a hard era to be a veteran because there was so much that was being taken out on people in the military because of the Vietnam War, even though the people that were in the military didn't say, yeah, let's go to war in Vietnam. That was just what happened, and there were a lot of people who were drafted and some enlisted for their personal reasons.
It was a difficult time for someone of my age group. I was 18. Mm-hmm. My brother had, I had just turned 18. He was almost 19, and or he was 19. We were a year and 1 month difference.
Yeah.
And we went into the Air Force together. Charlie wanted to go. He was a radical. He didn't believe in the war. But we decided, you know, if we don't go, I had to sign up for the selective service,
yeah.
And he got his draft notice.
Oof.
All at the same time. And because we didn't want to say, hey, we're deserters.
No.
That would have killed my dad.
Yeah.
Being a World War II veteran himself.
Mm-hmm.
And to leave, even though our mother died very young, she died when she was 60, 1990. And, you know, she was like, she held that family, I mean, together.
Mm-hmm.
But to get to the back to the facts here, Charlie and I went into the Air Force, and you're right. It was a time, you know, Woodstock was just got over, because mm-hmm. we went in, I think, in 1970 or the beginning of 71. I forgot, but
yeah,
we
Woodstock
both got
was 69.
Honorable discharges and
yeah.
all our benefits. And, you know, to be a young man, and to face, regardless whether you went to Vietnam or not, whether a bunch of us got Article 15s, that's a deduction in stripe and pay.
Uh-huh.
We were called down, we called the where the all the offices were, the head shed.
Yeah.
Well, we were with the civil engineers, right? And of all things, it came out in the base newspaper. A chaplain, young man, was found to have long shoulder-length hair. He had been wearing a short-haired wig.
Wow.
Nobody ever, you know,
they couldn't tell that it was a wig?
Not when he's at the chapel. And he's nowhere to be seen much anywhere else. And he was walking around with this, you know, in service on Sunday, and he had the other chaplains, like priests and everything, right? No one knew. So now that gave a little bit of suspicion as to, you know, who else is running around with long hair.
Oops.
Now, my friends and myself included, first of all, I got a tattoo of a smiley face. That was popular.
Yes,
it's 1970 or
yes.
71, right? Okay, that was a tattoo then. That came with defacing government property. An Article 15.
They call that defacing
that
government
property? That was defacing government property in 1971. You weren't allowed tattoos. You couldn't go out and get a tattoo.
But veterans before then, World War II, World War I, you see them with those guys.
Overseas.
They had tattoos.
Yep. Navy could
yeah.
have a tattoo.
Navy especially.
Yep. The Air Force did not allow tattoos. Okay, me and a bunch of guys, we get an Article 15 for that. No problem. You know, get over it. I've got two stripes, and I've got faded out green fatigues, right? Now, I lose the one stripe, and I have to sew one back on, and I didn't sew it on, so I was another Article 15 on top of that one for, being an airman basic.
Huh.
Like...
They knocked you out.
Impersonating an airman basic. So the rest of, I was known as Slick Sleeve. Until I'm like, hey, this is hurting my pocketbook, even though we only made 30-something bucks.
Yeah.
I sewed the patch back on.
That'd be enormously frustrating.
You know, I sewed them back on. I only, like, on one set of fatigues. And then, you know, the long hair. So we're all trimming up our hair, like around doing this white wall thing. And instead of like a 6 7/8 hat, you might have had a 7 1/4 hat with all your hair tucked under. And, you know, we're going around when we get off duty, it'd be like trying to part our hair down the middle and comb it. And some of the guys, you know, had pretty long hair. Believe it or not, after like about 5 months of not getting a regulation haircut and just making it look like they had one, we were called up to the head shed to remove our hats. Aren't you troops supposed to remove your hats when you walk in a building?
Oh.
And I was like, we knew we're busted. Somebody, you know, said, hey, that group over there walking around with. And we weren't, it was, you know, not just the white guys, some of the young black guys had their afros doing the same thing we were doing, and it was like, now it was pretty, there was no, you know, there was no, hey, isn't that hair a little bit big for you? Take your hat off. And they'd have long hair underneath it.
So there's a lot of Article 15s going around.
Oh, there was so many, I mean, there was, you know, forget about, that was the medial part. Uh-huh. There was so much of higher-ups being investigated by the OSI, the Office's Special Investigation. Mm-hmm. It was all corrupt. It was all big corruption. And it was, you know, we were just little peons that they were stepping on. And
they were stepping on you while they were getting away with more.
Yeah. We were just basically kids.
Yeah.
18, 19 years old, college-age kids. But we were ready, believe it or not, to defend our country. Yeah. And we knew. A guy just sent me about 2 years ago. I had my original prime beef patch. I was on prime beef unit, a readiness alert team, when I was in the civil engineers. And a guy saw my patch one day. I had it on a jacket. And he goes, oh, they made new patches now. I'm like, they did? He goes, yeah, they're actually in color.
Oh.
And he sent me one.
That was nice of him.
Yeah. In a magazine from the new Air Force issue of Prime Beef.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, oh, what a guy.
Did you have trouble adjusting after you got out, or was that fairly easy? Because I know that a lot of veterans back in those days, they weren't treated the way they are today, where everybody says thank you for your service, and there are special benefits for them. And back then, it was like baby killer. And
yeah, I got that without even, you know, I mean, people are ignorant to the fact, hey, I'm in an Air Force uniform, because you could fly military standby in an Air Force or your dress uniform.
Yeah.
So what are you doing, you know, getting, and they would always be at the Kennedy Airport, or they'd be at some airport, and, you know, it's like, come on, kids, don't you have anything better to do? Yeah. I mean, this ain't going to stop no war. The war's never going to, I felt as though it was never going to stop.
Yeah. You know? It seemed like it wasn't going to stop. It just kept going and going.
It was, you know, and then eventually, 75, but I was already out of the Air Force by that point, to come into a country that was I think it was 74, Nixon was impeached or he stepped out. And
articles of impeachment were filed. He resigned. I believe he lost I believe that they voted to go to a Senate trial and he resigned in August 1974.
And at that time, there was no adjustment because I didn't have time to think about the past. I started working, doing roofing, and always had an interest in motorcycles, so I became a motorcycle guy with the chopper and the engineer boots. I still have I don't have a chopper anymore, but I still wear the engineer boots and I still ride a motorcycle. But I lived the fast lane when I got out.
You started the Legion Riders.
That is correct. Yes,
and
sir.
And for people who don't know,
yes, sir.
The Legion Riders are?
The Legion Riders are a charter membership of the American Legion. And they are a motorcycle group, and they do good things.
Mm-hmm.
They do. Myself, at the time, I was the commander of the Wilmington American Legion. And before I became the commander, I was the vice commander.
Huh?
And I was also chaplain. And guys were talking, you know, gee, Mike, well, you know, we ought to get a few guys with motorcycles and start up a Legion Riders. I said, hey, I'll be all for it. I'll even get the ball rolling. Mm-hmm. And I did. And a couple of guys signed up with bikes. And I kept in contact with the state commander of the Legion Riders. And he told me, you know, I go, look, I got, you know, I got like six or seven guys. He goes, you got any guys that might want to sign up? I go, well, I got a few, but they don't have a bike. Are they going to get a bike? Yeah, they want to get a bike. He goes, sign them up and get enough guys on the for a quota. And I did. And, gee, we had a big event. We had the big shots come into the Legion post. And we had my wife got a big cake. We had food. We had a, you know, good time. But there's the problem. I was the only Legion Rider that showed up.
Oh, my. Oh, my.
I'm serious. A lot of other people, the place was full, veterans.
Uh-huh.
And I had to battle. It took me a year battling. These old-timers were like, we don't want a bike group in here. We don't want to deal with bikers.
They're thinking Hell's Angels.
Yeah. And I'm like, it's not like that. You know, you're missing the point. These are veterans.
Yeah.
Oh, there's still motorcycle guys. We're going to have motorcycles running in and out and the noise and the neighbors. And I got the vote a year later. In every meeting, I would like to bring up the old business of the Legion Riders charter membership.
Mm-hmm.
Can we have a vote? Okay. One member showed up one night. And he says, you know, if the commander feels this strongly, and if Mike has got, you know, worked this hard to have a Legion Riders in the Legion, I'm casting the winning vote.
Huh.
And we got it by one vote.
Wow.
So now everything was all a success, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't have the vest on me now, but for 2 years, 2015 and 2016, I kept trying to get the lead. I wasn't the commander anymore, but I was trying to get the Legion Riders up and running. Nobody seemed interested. Okay. I kind of fell away from the Legion because of, you know, while I was commander, and I'll say this, No, I will not buy a round for the bar. Mm-hmm. But I will advise some of you to maybe think about, you know, checking out at the VA hospital in Bedford.
Mm-hmm.
And on the side, you know, hey, you know, as your commander, you know, you may find you, do you have a problem with what you're doing?
Yeah.
Not mentioning names. But I wasn't the most likable guy in the post, let's put it that way. There's a lot of them, I was this biker guy that started the Legion Riders and would think nothing of telling you, I think, you know, hey, that's about the fourth or fifth time you've repeated yourself to me, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I heard you the first time.
Right.
And I, you know, I may come off as a rough exterior sometimes, but I'm really not. And meaning, I know how to handle myself. You know, you could look at my record. I have not been in any fist fights or anything to where, you know, would be discriminating against me. So I know how to deal. And plus, being a retired security officer, I learned some valuable lessons.
Mm-hmm.
And it was at a mall. It was at the Billerica Mall.
Oh.
For 10 years, I was the supervisor.
Mm-hmm.
So I was I'll never forget. You know, one night, the police come in and they're like, you know, Mike, you know where we are. If you ever need us, you just give us a call.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I know that. I appreciate that. And they backed me up all 100%, more than 100%. I still see them from time to time, and it's a big, not a handshake. They hug me. They give me a big hug.
Did you ever have any big problems at the mall?
I never had too many, but yes, there were problems. Uh-huh. Oh yeah, there were many. There were many problems. But once again, you learn diplomacy. You learn, you know,
yeah.
It's like, hey, you know, yeah, I got plenty of backup, but I can handle this myself.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, that's what my job is. That's why I have this badge.
Yeah.
And you know, I mean, I always was in the combat. First, I first started out, Wayne, right, as the mall security officer.
Yeah.
And I went into the manager, and I said, hey, you know, this type of a uniform, sir, might be good for, like, Bloomingdale's or Macy's. He goes to me, what are you talking about, Mike? I go, you expect a security guard to deal with this particular place? I need cargo pants. Combat boots, you know, a good jacket, and he's like, go to the police survival store and get whatever you need. Thank you, sir. So I was walking around in black fatigue pants and always had my, you know, combat boots spit shined. I was like a SWAT team.
So you looked more than just...
Yeah, I had the pistol
guy.
Belt on and I had handcuffs. I mean, I didn't carry a gun because you don't want a gun in a situation of a mall security guard.
Yeah.
Because what are you going to do, open fire on somebody?
In a mall?
Yeah, you can't, you know, that's crazy to even think that.
Yeah. Who's the person who's had the most influence over you? The one that you look up to.
As a family type of person? Or
anybody.
Anybody?
The one who's helped to shape you, the one that's had the biggest influence in helping you be who you are.
You know, you're not going to believe this, but I'll tell you. Red Skelton.
Red Skelton?
Freddy the Freeloader.
Yeah.
And his annex and his skits. And, you know, I used to sit there. I mean, my mother... When I was very much seriously a clown when I was a little kid.
Mm-hmm.
I dressed up like a clown. Halloween, if it was Halloween, I was a clown. There was no wondering what Mike's going to be, right? And always putting on the shows and the puppets. But Red Skelton, I, you know, to this day, I mean, I just, you know, he was just and the more I found out about him, the more I find, there will never be another Red Skelton.
Oh, no.
And, of course, you know, I can look up to him. But I find myself more and more like being like him. You know, and learning the things that he did that I didn't even know. Like, he did his own portraits, painting. Yep. I don't do that, but, you know.
He was a writer. He was an artist. He was a poet.
Yeah.
He was a very generous man.
He
called himself a clown. And he was a great pantomimist, as well as having a bunch of other very interesting characters.
Clem Kadiddlehopper.
Yeah.
And he had so many.
I remember Clem Kadiddlehopper. Well, for you.
Yeah. That's where I get a lot of, you know, the drive is from him.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, Freddie the Freeloader, you know, I've even made, right, a skit where, you know, how he had the old shack.
Yep.
I don't buy a dump, I buy railroad tracks or someplace.
Yes.
Right? Well, you know, I made this old shack-looking thing, just a fake frontage thing. And, you know, maybe someday, I don't know, I might get back to that project. Uh-huh. And, you know, bring it in, CC's Clownsby Shack.
Yeah.
You know? And do a little skit right out
there
of the
you
shack.
Go. Yeah, I think he also had Sheriff Deadeye.
Yeah, oh yeah.
He was a cowboy too.
Yeah.
Just like you.
Yeah, that's right. See what I mean? I remember Deadeye. Matter of fact, they had him on with, there was a show with Chuck Connors.
The Rifleman?
I think was on one of the Deadeye episodes.
Oh.
Along with maybe Barney Fife. I can't remember the details right now, but yeah.
Now you've gone, everybody goes through times of challenge, and you've certainly had many of those in your life. I mean, you've experienced loss, and you've come through a lot in your life. How do you do that? What do you tell people who are going through extremely difficult times now, which there are many people who are?
To have faith and hope. And there's always a light at the end of the tunnel. No matter how depressing and no matter how down in the dumps or how bad you have it, you have to, you know, look for a brighter future. Whether you can't do it on your own, and you seek help, and you know, God is a very important aspect in my life.
Mm-hmm.
I, you know, have at the death of my daughter and losing my brother 2 years earlier, I came to the conclusion that for my sanity alone, I had to do something more. So I became a pastor. And I studied, and I took the courses. I'm actually involved. I'm halfway through a course right now.
Huh.
And I've been studying. It's an open book, but when you open up the Bible as your open book, you can research, and it can take you a while. And you know, I just give God the glory ahead of time.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm not doing it to earn a piece of paper. I'm doing it because I'm thankful that I can do it.
Have you had a time when you absolutely positively knew that God was there and it just came out of nowhere?
There's been many times that I've experienced that.
Huh. That's always a surprise.
Just the other day, I came into the studio last week after being attacked by hornets in
the
face. Whole, I was getting something out of the shed, and they had a nest up underneath the rafter.
Uh-huh.
I didn't even know it, and they attacked me. And I was just bit up so bad that I knowing that I'm not allergic, but when you get bit in the face multiple times, you can tend to worry when you, but the good Lord, you know, stopped in the hive from really doing me in. I could have got a lot more, and I knew it.
You could have been killed.
I mean, he directed the hive in a different direction, and I was able to regroup myself and realize, you know, how bad am I bit. And
yeah.
So.
That must have been scary.
Yeah. But I didn't panic, and I knew that, you know, I'd be all right. And I put cold water on my face and watched my face swell up. It looked like I went a few rounds with some prize fighter. But by the time I got to the studio, I was all right.
Yeah.
You know?
Now, one of the things you told me is that you go to schools. And
well, these are home courses.
Yeah.
They send me the course, and I do the booklets and send back the.
But you go to schools as a clown, and you entertain children.
You know, I'd like to do more than just, like, I felt like I was teaching them how to draw.
There you go.
And with that said, right, Wayne, if I could give you this right here. This is one of the pictures that we did in the studio the other night. I wanted to give you this because it's made with a W. I'll roll it back up.
It's very good. Oh, I should hold this upright.
That, you see the W?
I do. That's extremely clever. Oh, and you signed it.
I signed it for you.
That's very good. Now, we also, this is very interesting, and I'm going to treasure this. Thank you so much.
You're welcome, sir.
But
when I thought, you know, hey, I made one with an M. They're all out on the table over there. If you want another one, you can look through them. You feel free.
Now, there are some other things. Before the show, we're hanging out in the studio, and he is quite the artist. I'll show you some of what he's done. He's got this one. And then here's the sheriff. And this is CC.
Now see, I learned these out of a book. This is the teardrop.
Oh.
Made from a teardrop. That's one upside down. And the other one is a hairpin, they call that. You make a hairpin, and you can construct almost any kind of a, whatever you want.
And then here's, this is an interesting one. Who's this?
That is nobody. That's just a hobo. And that's
hobos are somebody.
Well, you know what? I got to tell you this. Right now, I'm working on a book, The Hobo.
Huh.
I have actually got a book I'm working on.
Here's a little baby. And then we get these big ones down here. I want to be careful with these.
Yeah, now that's the hairpin.
That's
the hairpin. Just a loop up and over.
And we have, a big version of the cowboy. You are quite the artist. And we also have.
And that's Cece.
A big Cece waving.
That's the, like, my signature. I sign a lot. When I sign, like, I meant to tell you this. On Valentine's Day and Christmas, I send in over at least on a minimum of 100 cards to the Children's Hospital.
Oh, my.
All signed in picture of CC Clownsby and Cowboy Mike on it. Let me just... That's a book that I wrote.
Oh, well, thank you.
You wouldn't even have to do the interview. You could have read that book.
No, it's more fun to talk with you.
I'm just kidding. But like I was telling you about the poems, books that I have. All right, let me do this first.
Yeah?
Yeah, I got you a whole set of them.
Oh, boy.
I'm up. And these are poems of over 50 years of in the collections.
So you've been doing poetry for 50 years?
I've been over 50 years.
Good for you.
The other ones, who knows what happened to them, but some of them date back to the 70s.
Thank you. I'll always treasure that.
But what I wanted to do, if I may, I hope I didn't, well, I marked it. If I could read, oh, here it is. If I could just read one poem.
Absolutely.
Do you mind?
Please do.
This is out of volume 5. And this is why I want to read it, is because in the clown world, this is who I am. And the title is, Who's Clowning Who? How does someone end up being a clown? Does the person have to look funny? Is it something the person said that was funny? Ask yourself, was the clown even funny? Let me, as a clown, let you in on something. A lot of clowns are very, very serious and don't take things as being a joke at all. Life sometimes isn't always fun and games. Some clowns are in it to help the ones that have real pain and have been hurt real bad. If the clown has just helped one of these people and made them feel good and wanted, that's the clown to take your hat off to. That's the clown who sees it through. That's the clown for you. The end.
Very nice.
And that's in volume 5.
Yeah. One of the things you told me before we went on was you said that you don't drink, no. You don't do drugs, and that when you go to kids, you are somebody that you don't scare them, that there's somebody that you are, well, you didn't say this, but you are somebody that they can look up to.
A lot of kids are afraid of clowns.
Yeah.
For the most part, you know, a stranger and looking kind of freaky in a way, but mm-hmm. when the kids get to know me and when I'm around the kids, it just becomes like, what clown? Where's Mike? You know, this guy has just captured them. Yeah. Now, if I can tell you real quickly of this episode that happened a year ago. Mm-hmm. A good friend of mine's daughter was turning 13, and he gives me a call and he says, Mike, I need to ask you a big favor. I go, what's that? He goes, my daughter's bummed out. CC Clownsby's not going to be at her birthday party. And I'm thinking, you know, 13-year-old girl? You thought, you know, think she'd want, like, you know, more grown-up thing than a clown? Oh, no. And I says to him, well, under one condition, and this is right around the time we were filming Mr. Bojangles.
Uh-huh. Oh, right? Yes.
Right? So I says to my friend, I go, look, under one condition, for the grand finale of the show, you're going to put the Mr. Bojangles on, and you're going to dance to the song while I play it.
Mm-hmm.
You got a deal. And we pulled it off, and it's on YouTube. My wife filmed it. Put it on her. It's on. If you look up CC Clownsby and mm-hmm. Company, all these other films come up, and
yes.
It's, you know, it's pretty, it's grown to be quite the entertainment thing.
Uh-huh.
And he did the version of, I tried to get him into the studio with me to do it. He did such a good job, but he got tied up with other things. You know, that's what happens.
Yeah.
You know? But he did him and I did a version of Mr. Bojangles that's just it's a classic now.
Mm-hmm.
Another classic too is, if you ever get a chance to see this one. Of course, CC Clownsby for Christmas gets a Bluetooth microphone from Santa Claus.
They're very nice of Santa to do that.
I know, wasn't it? We all know who my Santa Claus is.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll tell you, I made a film. My wife filmed it with the Bluetooth, right? Good old St. Patrick's Day came rolling around before you know it.
Uh-huh.
And I took my two buddies, puppets, the commissioner of Clownsbury and the chief, and we did up all the old-time Irish favorites.
Oh,
and if you you will love the music.
The St. Patrick's Day special.
It was the, without even a green screen, we took a piece of green material and we made shamrocks and we put it on a curtain rod thing. Yeah.
So we're coming down to 1 second.
1 second. Well,
but thank you so much for being here with us.
Thank you.
And I wish you all the best. Just one last thing.
Okay.
For people who say to themselves, and there are a lot of people who go, oh, I'm not creative. I'm not good enough. What do you tell those people? How do you help them to?
By not giving up and overcome your mistakes. All them pictures that I made, each one might have a mistake in there, but you counteract the mistake. If you're doing a song and you forgot the words, don't stop and say, I got to do it again. Just move on.
Mm-hmm.
Just move on.
Well, it was a real privilege to have you
we'll
here.
We'll have to do another part, too.
We will. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
And thank you all for watching. And we'll catch you next time on Celebrate Life.